I was born in Manhattan, in New York City, in 1964, and I grew up in Astoria. I remember going to a neighbor's house. That neighbor had a piano, and I would be so drawn to that piano because it allowed me to play stuff that was so different than a guitar, and to me, playing that piano was so exciting.
My mom says that I could play the piano before I could even see the keys. That's how she describes it to me. She says that I would stand next to the piano and I would reach for the keys and I would play like Cuckoo Cuckoo Chutevi School. It was just as much a part of my life as, you know, eating, playing, sleeping, anything.
Well, I'm a first generation Ukrainian. My parents were born in Ukraine. Interview. They both came over here after World War II. They subsequently met here at Suyuzuka, the UNA estate in New York. They both had summer jobs there. My dad was my first teacher. I wanted to play trumpet originally, and he suggested maybe he could teach me drums. And I thought, great, I'll hang out with dad some more. I had some affinity for it. I liked it. Through grade school and high school, I became better and better, and realized that if I went to a music school, or at least went to study music, that would be something I'd be interested in, and I would keep going with it. And the idea of being an entertainer through music was very exciting.
Darka grew up in a suburb of Detroit, Michigan, and grew up in a community that was a little bit, I would say, younger than the community that I grew up in. My parents were of a generation that was sort of more like Darka's grandparents. And as a result, you know, Darka's parents were more educated, let's say. You know, they were educated here in the States. They came over from Ukraine and from Germany and stuff at a young age, but they were, you know, educated here in America. So I believe that as far as her knowledge of Ukrainian specifically was better than mine, I mean, from a language standpoint. My parents really were essentially farmers, you know, and they didn't have a lot of schooling. The Ukrainian language that I learned from them was, you know, wasn't like a very, let's say, highly literate language. But that's something that I think Darka sort of influenced me, and being around her and her family influenced me a bit. I think that my Ukrainian got quite a lot better being around her and her family.
Ukrainian was my first language, and that's the language that's the deepest ingrained in terms of who I am, you know. I mean, the Ukrainian language is the language that I first sang in. I don't even remember singing in English as a child. It's created this archetype, this mythical place in my heart and in my mind, you know, this real cultural part that, you know, where my parents came from and where my grandparents came from. Going to Ukrainos Nastol, we were taught about Ukrainian culture and about Ukrainian history, and it was all very, very mythical, you know. It was just this place, and under Soviet rule, and, you know, we were oppressed people and all of this. So I just felt like I had a different kind of upbringing. Actually, you know, all of my friends were the same like me, first generation Ukrainian, so I didn't feel like I was any different until maybe I got into high school and was more involved with non-Ukrainian people. And then I realized I have something different than a lot of people in America have. I have a very strong, rich cultural identity, and it's a completely extra piece of the puzzle for me. I'm born in America, but I had this really big cultural and ethnic background that other people didn't have.
Being a Ukrainian American is very interesting. It's very interesting today, to be of my generation. Growing up, there was no way that the Soviet Union would ever cease to be. There was no way that Ukraine would realistically ever be its own country. There was no way that communism would cease to be a major power on the planet. And it was a very dual life that we sort of had. We had our American life, which was school, which was work for my parents, which were my school friends. And then there was a very sharp delineation, a sharp split, which was the Ukrainian part of my life. And Plast and Ukrainian culture and Ukrainian food and Ukrainian dances and Ukrainian zabavas and Ukrainian music. And that part was very special because not everybody had that. My American friends didn't know what it was like to go to a zabava. You could explain that's like a dance, it's like a ball, but you can't really explain what a zabava is like. There seems to be a generation that came over here in the 50s, my parents, and their generation. My grandparents, came over. Many of them were doctors, lawyers, professionals that ended up taking menial work, menial jobs, just to survive, to get away. For them, the price of leaving communism, leaving what was becoming this mass evil Soviet empire, was worth mopping floors. And slowly they built up the diaspora in Chicago, in New York, Philadelphia, over the course of 50 years.
In college, we were we were still involved in Ukrainian stuff, and we were getting involved in political activities, like Тусом. Товариство української студіючої молоді імені Мікношко, Микола Мікношко. So it was an offshoot of, I guess, UKK or maybe AUN, I'm not sure. But, so it was very political, and we would go to Washington, D.C. or New York and have demonstrations about Soviet occupation in Ukraine and freeing political prisoners. I mean, I remember going to demonstrations my whole life, just holding up signs and trying to get the message about Ukraine out there, because barely anybody knew what Ukraine was back then, 70s and 80s, well, 80s. I mean, Ukraine to us was like this mythical place. We just never thought we'd go there, and that was way before, its independence, and we just never thought we'd see it be independent in our lifetime.
The first time that I remember performing in sort of a quote-unquote professional capacity was with a Ukrainian band called Dunai. And it was a bunch of friends of mine and I that got together and performed at the St. George Festival on 7th Street in Manhattan. Dotka and I were both involved in something called the Ukrainian Student Association at the time. Which I was the head of the national executive of the organization at the time, and we were having an evening in honor of political prisoners, which was to take place in Detroit, and that's where Dotka was from. And we put together this event, and it involved poetry readings, poems written by political prisoners.
And a bunch of people from New York came to Detroit for this evening of Poshani Polikviaznyo. And so most of them were doing poetry readings, but they wanted me to come up with a musical interlude. You can't just have poetry for 2 hours, We needed to kind of make it more interesting. So they said, Dotka, will you take care of the music part? So I was ready to, play and sing by myself, or, I don't know what I was planning on doing. But anyway, Slavko came to town, and I knew he was a musician. But, we didn't plan anything. He just came over to our house and said, let's see if we can work out some songs.
And it was just me on guitar and both of us singing. And the first time we rehearsed. We just rehearsed like the day before in the afternoon. I think it's the first time we sang together and realized how well we blended together vocally and how well we sort of read each other in terms of timing, in terms of, you know, performance, the way we sang, the way we breathed together. I think it was shocking. I mean, we both, I think, were surprised at how easily it went and how easily we sort of fell in step with each other. The following evening when we performed at this event, I think the entire crowd was just as stunned at how we really seemed to blend well together. There was a real effortless harmony between us.
When we first did our first performance at that concert, Poshani Polibiasnyu, we really didn't expect the reaction we got from people. We never did that before. I mean, Slavko and I both played and sang music our whole lives, but we never had that emotional reaction from people. That was the first. I mean, people would always, I'm sure, tell Slavko and tell me, oh, you're really good and you really performed well and everything. But nobody ever told me before that day, you really touched me. I think we hit a nerve and we didn't expect that. You know, and we realized that we were stirring something up in people emotionally. Because you can demonstrate all you want. You can demonstrate all you want, but, you know, until you hit people on an emotional level, you know, that's really where you can, you know, affect people, is making them realize, you know, we're not just demonstrating Soviet occupation in Ukraine, or we're not just demonstrating, you know, for the release of, you know, Moroz or Sus or whatever. We're, you know, this is something different. We are trying to show people that Ukrainian culture and Ukrainian music is alive and well in this next generation of Ukrainians in America.
Dadka and I recorded a demo together that was just a four-track little cassette recording of a number of songs that were just acoustic guitar and multiple vocals. And really, to us, the whole music thing, well, it was really, it started off just being really a hobby. I mean, when we recorded this demo, I mean, we had no purpose in mind, per se, professionally, except that, well, when we put this demo together and circulated it among friends, we got such enthusiastic responses as a result of that, that we thought, well, why not put an album out? Why not do what a lot of other people have done and record an album and distribute it? So we thought, well, okay, why not? It certainly wasn't a career move per se. We just enjoyed it so much, and we thought, well, we'll sell some albums. It'll pay for itself, hopefully, and we'll perform maybe at some festivals, maybe do some more concerts. Because that first concert that we did, it was so exciting to get such a positive response from that. So we thought, well, we could do this. Again, it wasn't a career choice in terms of, like, we thought we were going to drop everything and suddenly go out on the road, because that wasn't an option here in North America, to be a Ukrainian musician professionally. Well, there were some people who did it in terms of wedding bands, you know, but that's not what we did. We didn't play polkas and tangos. Well, we played tangos, but... And we didn't do dance music, per se. We recorded music that was meant to, you were meant to listen to, maybe even with headphones. I mean, that's the kind of approach we took to it. It wasn't the kind of thing that you'd put on and let's have a zabava.
It was just fresh at the time. Nobody was doing that kind of stuff, you know? So I think people really responded, and it gave us kind of a mission. I think that's when our mission started. Two Ukrainian-American people that meet, fall in love, and start to create music, and try to come up with, I don't know how much it was, $10,000 to do our first record, and begging people for money, and taking out loans, and, you know, trying to make people believe that what we're doing is worthy of that money and of that attention.
And I think that what also sort of fueled our passion for it was the events that followed very shortly after we recorded these demos, and it was Chernobyl.
We recorded them at my house, and I was listening to that tape at the very end of April of 86. I had big headphones on, and I was listening to the tracks, and my mother comes home, and nobody had any of the facts right after Chernobyl happened. There was, you know, the news was sketchy, and people were guessing what happened, and, you know, they found evidence of radiation, you know, hundreds of miles away, and so nobody really had any of the facts. But my mother came home, and she heard something from someone, or, anyway, this is what she said. I'm listening to, you know, a singing mom or something. She takes one of the headphones off of my ears, and she says, "Nuclear bomb on Kyiv."
Growing up, if you ever saw a story about Ukraine or someone mentioned Ukraine, you know, in a book or in a movie, it was like, "Oh, did you hear? You know, whereas now it's very common. It's not that big of a deal, which is great, you know, especially after Chernobyl. You know, that unfortunately was a mass exposure, both literally and culturally, that people all of a sudden realized, oh, there is this country. It's a country. It's not just part of the Soviet Union. It's a country with its own culture. That was 86, 85, 86. And, you know, at the time, we never would have thought, oh, in 5 years, 6 years, you know, the rules will be totally different.
To sit there and listen, you know, to something that you've just recorded, something that, you know, again, has roots that stretch back, and you have this sense of history, and you have this connection with music, with a language that your parents grew up with, that your grandparents, your great-grandparents grew up with, and to have this sort of connection with a country that is not free, and then to suddenly hear about this nuclear disaster, it was extraordinary at the time, and it gave a sense of urgency to what we were doing, because this was our homeland. I mean, this is the homeland of our parents, and to be connected to it and yet disconnected. I think that music that we created was a way of connecting ourselves to Ukraine. I think the purpose of it, recording Ukrainian songs and creating Ukrainian songs, was really to get others, our peers, kids that we grew up with, interested in Ukrainian songs. It was something that influenced us very deeply. Ukrainian music was something that was just in our blood, you know? But, like, the idea of doing that, I think it really only hit me later that you could actually do this. You could actually create music, record it, and mass-produce it and distribute it on a large scale. I think it took a little time to sink in, but I realized that, oh my gosh, I mean, this is the kind of thing that American bands do all the time in the record industry. I mean, they record albums, they go out, they perform, they promote their music. And on a small scale, that's what Ukrainian bands were doing in North America throughout the 70s.
We were trying to make Ukrainian music something that was, you know, hip and cool and, you know, just more for young people. That was the point. That was the point of what we did. We wanted to make it, you know, something that was new and something that was just different, you know, because none of our friends would really listen to Ukrainian music other than going to Zabava and listening to Zabava music and Kolomeikas and stuff. And you did that once every few months, go to some Zabava. And that's all it was. It wasn't something you would stick in your car stereo and listen to it for pleasure. That's who we had to be true to ourselves, you know, was to play and perform and arrange the music in a way that was true to ourselves. So we couldn't imitate or emulate, you know, something that was what we thought was what Ukrainian people wanted to hear. It would just have to be a true expression of us, which was just the whole combination of who we were. We were not Americans, we were not Ukrainians, we were both.
Certainly, I think it's easier for people who are musicians to relate to something that way, because it's music. It doesn't matter what language it's in. It's easier for musicians. But I think the point was to interest Ukrainian Americans who were not musicians, who maybe were just like me in the sense that, well, they got to a certain age and they discovered, you know, rock and roll or something, and they couldn't care less about the old Ukrainian songs. It was I think, more a point of trying to get those type of people reinterested, or at least interested, in this musical heritage that we have.
Natalia's record collection actually influenced me. So, you know, she was the older sister with the record collection. So I would raid her record collection, and I remember listening to Heart, Anna Nancy Wilson, and try to copy them, and we would try to copy them, and, you know, Queen, Night at the Opera, and, you know, Turtles.
Stevie Wonder. And that is, of course, mixed in with Veryoka,
yeah,
and Czerwona Ruta. Mm. I mean, we grew up with both of these, you know, types of music all concurrently happening, which is why I think it makes it so rich for us, because we have these influences from Ukraine and Eastern Europe, and we love that. And and our parents also had a wide collection of, you know, gypsy music and tangos and, you know, Jewish, beautiful Jewish music and, you know, Latin, you know, bossa novas. I mean, really, a really great mix. And, of course, opera for Velbert, yeah, but, you know, opera, you know, well-known Ukrainian Dmytro Hmetyuk, you know, who else can you think of that time? I mean, we heard all this all the time. You know?
Sofia Rotrados,
yeah,
lots of that.
We loved her. Along with Donna Summer, you know, disco. Just, you know, it's just this amazing mix of stuff, you know, that we grew up with.
And you know, Slavko and I were really into having it technologically and, you know, have a sophisticated sound in terms of recording. But that was secondary. It was all about the music. And, you know, you can hear something that's recorded terribly, but if it's edgy or different or original or truly unique, then that's what's important. You know, it's not about how great everything sounds in terms of, you know, the audio fidelity of it.
We thought, what if we just put together an ensemble of just a couple of more musicians, but not like a drummer, because that right off the bat would be sort of the cliche, you know, that you have a drummer and boom, you're a wedding band. I mean, that's what we felt at the time. And it just so happened that two friends of Darko's from Detroit, Andriy and Yurko Stasiu, who are twins, one of them played piano and the other played bass. And they had played in wedding bands before that and stuff. But they, I think, were in tune with what we were trying to do musically, which was not to be a wedding band, not to be an umpapa type of band, but to do songs that were a little bit more interesting, a little bit, that spoke a little bit more to the mind, and not just the sort of get up and dance kind of, you know, mentality. I think that at the time that Darka and I started recording material together and performing, I think the norm at that time was either you were a Ukrainian polka band, you know, kind of like a wedding band, kind of a dance band, or there were a lot of, let's say, ensembles that featured women singing. I don't think that there was, well, there were few people, if any, doing music that was, well, dare I say, a little more sophisticated in terms of arrangement, and let's say a little bit more risky in terms of genre. I mean, to do a reggae song on a Ukrainian album, I really don't know of anyone who tried that before we did. And I'm not saying ours was the best, but it was certainly a risk, and I think it's a risk that paid off. Some of the other styles that we got involved with were, again, these were our attempts at something that was not often done. I mean, to do a Veselovsky tune like Tis Lubov Sobi Ne Zhartuj or Yasno Tobi, these were tunes that back in the 50s and 60s were, let's say, a little bit more of the time. In other words, jazz was big in the 50s and even still, let's say, in the 60s. But we were doing these tunes in the 80s and nobody else was doing that style of music, I mean reggae or jazz, in the context of Ukrainian songs, Ukrainian language songs. I think that the arrangements that we chose, coupled with the fact that it was a male and a female voice, there were few people, again, if any, that were doing it at that time. The few that possibly did exist at the time that we were recording and performing were very much more folk-oriented.
I always sort of knew that there was this duo called Darka and Slavko. I knew they kind of existed. Again, because the community is so tight-knit, I had never seen him perform. I had never met him or spoken with him or Darka. But you would hear about them. You would see their names on marquees or read about them in the Solda or other newspaper things. So I sort of knew this guy named Slavko existed. A mutual friend of ours, of Slavko's and mine, was doing a recording, and they had asked me to play drums and bass on it. The fascinating thing was on the drive home, after that day, after having spent 8-9 hours there, I turned to the person who was driving home, whose project it was. I said, what a great place. It was just nice. It was a nice vibe. You know, so much better than the last place we had worked at. And Slav was just great. I mean, he was just so efficient and nice and friendly and laughed. And you know, I made him laugh. And he made me laugh. And again, the person I was with, she turned to me and just said, yeah, he's great. And it's something, you know, with his vision. And I turned to him and said, what do you mean? His vision? What do you, what? Oh, well, you know, with his eyes, you know, you can't really see. I said, what are you talking about? Well, he's blind. He's essentially blind. He has retinitis pigmentosa. He can't see. And I was dumbfounded. I mean, I had no idea. I consider myself a pretty observant person. And here he had been spending the entire 8-hour day setting up microphones, sitting in front of a board with literally 300 buttons on it. A mixing board, and knowing what's where, and adjusting things on the fly, and making adjustments, and working a computer, and coming into the sound room, and setting up a microphone, and plugging in cables, and putting microphones next to drum sets, and moving drums, and moving chairs. And I had no concept that he had any kind of impairment. It just never dawned on me. I saw his computer had big text on, big font on it, and it just sort of didn't register, like, okay, whatever. I guess he just likes to have things set up that way. And it just made such an impression on me that here was this guy that not once during the day did he ever complain, or he was never impinged by his vision. Someone who was so multiply talented, singer, songwriter, guitarist, piano player, bass player, orchestrator, engineer, producer, sushi lover, you know, so many things the guy does so well.
I think all of the songs that we used to perform, that Darka and I used to perform together, they were all very special to me because, well, we chose those songs. I mean, we didn't write many of them. They were pre-existing songs. But we did write a number of them as well. I think that because they were in the Ukrainian language, we had a certain freedom with them that we probably wouldn't have otherwise had if we were singing in English. And I think that that applied to our musical treatment of those songs as well, because it was sort of like another arena. It wasn't, we weren't competing with the American market per se. We didn't have to make it sound any particular way. We could make it sound any way we wanted. And I think that writing English language songs and performing in America, in American venues, you have a different expectation, or at least I feel that there's a different expectation. I'm going to be compared with the next guy who's trying to land a record deal or is really trying to write a hit song or something like that. I didn't have that feeling at all in the Ukrainian music world, in the Ukrainian music industry, if you could consider that there was a Ukrainian music industry. Back then, I think there sort of was. It was a fledgling industry, but at any rate, it did exist. There were a lot of North American singers and bands who did perform at various festivals all over North America and stuff. I think that to us, we weren't in any sort of competition with anyone. We were just creating the kind of music that we would listen to ourselves. A lot of it certainly was based on folk music, songs that were recorded many times before, but it was our take on those songs through the lens of kids who grew up in America and were influenced by bands like the Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin, you know, popular bands of the time. The thing that I have to say creates a little bit of a different twist on it is that I think the music that we grew up with, Ukrainian music specifically, was very European, and I think that led to a big influence toward the jazz side of things.
They were the cutting edge at the time, you know, in the 80s. I mean, what they did was really revolutionary because they brought an American pop sound, and they melded that with traditional Ukrainian music, but other influences too. You know, they brought in all kinds of world music influences into it. And their later albums even had, like, country influence. And, you know, so I think that's what she was just talking about, you know, experimentation. They were doing it back then. And, you know, the performances always contained that.
Czerwona Ruta is usually in a minor key the whole way. But we wanted to make it reggae style, and reggae can be also very political, you know, as in Bob Marley. But it's also very happy, joyous music, you know. So we just thought, you know, Czerwona Ruta has been done a million times. If we're going to do this, we really have to do it wild, and we really have to do it different. So we were just trusting our intuition, and we just tried to do it in a reggae way, and I remember going to some record store in St. Mark's Place, or somewhere in the East Village of New York, and listening to a reggae song on the radio there, or on the, you know, the sound system there in the record store. And I was actually singing Chiruana Ruta in a major key to that. And I just thought, well, we could, you know, we just both thought that changing it around a little would be cool. And we just thought Vladimir Ivashuk was a groundbreaking composer. And, you know, we didn't think he'd mind if we screwed around with his arrangement a little bit and really tried to push the envelope, you know, and take it to another level and try to do it in a way that nobody ever did.
Sometimes being Ukrainian was enough. And it didn't have to be great. It was like, Ми всі українці, з нами, you know, we're all Ukrainians, that's enough. Yay. Dadek and Slavka were like, yeah, we're all Ukrainians, but that's not enough. The music has to be really great. And the arrangements have to be really great and have to be done, performed really well. And it's not enough that we have, you know, Vyshevini Sorochkin. That's not enough. And I just loved that. You know, I appreciated that and I saw that because I was on the same page. You know, for me, playing music is it's a right. You know, it's like you have to respect it, and you shouldn't abuse that right by having a poor performance. And the duo was it encompassed everything to me that a successful duo should be. Number one, musically they just blended so well. They worked so well together musically. Their voices worked well. You didn't know, there was no predefined parts. What they could do seemed limitless.
I would have to say that the concert that influenced me most, I believe, as a performer, I think I'd have to say the festival in Chervona Ruta, the Chervona Ruta Festival in Chernivtsi, in Ukraine. The response from the audience, just everything that was going on at the time before the wall came down and stuff, the enthusiasm of the crowd, how we were received, I think that certainly affected me more than any other show that I've been a part of. It was historic, and I think that we only realized after the fact what kind of impact it had on the musical world, on the political world, and it's something that you can only appreciate in hindsight. To then have people in Ukraine reacting in such a way was absolutely an extraordinary experience, something that would change me for the rest of my life.
The person who produced or executive produced our second album was Bohdan Timic, who owned a company called Yevshan in Canada, and he was part of our second album. He basically executive produced it. So he told us that there's an organization in Canada called Kobza, and they are they want to send some North American acts to Ukraine for this big Ukrainian festival, pop Ukrainian music festival, in the name of Volodymyr Ivashuk. And they wanted to know who Bohdan Timic thinks would be good candidates for that, to represent North American Ukrainian music.
We found ourselves on a plane to Moscow, and there were no direct flights to Kyiv at the time, from North America at least. And we flew to Moscow, and then from Moscow I believe we flew to Lviv directly, if I'm not mistaken. At this point, that memory is a little bit hazy. And then eventually took a train from Lviv down to Chernivtsi.
And this is right when we arrived in Moscow. This is our band. That's Slavka, that's me, that's Yurko Stasiu, that's Kevin Roth, and that's Andriy Stasiu in Red Square. And the first time we flew over Ukraine, when I realized we were landing, I completely broke into tears. Suddenly, you know, my whole life was flashing in front of me, like all these years thinking about Ukraine and will Ukraine ever be free, and, you know, I just couldn't believe I was actually traveling to Ukraine, seeing Ukrainian soil, you know, Ukrainianism. Everything was poetic to me, you know, because Darovotam, Ukrainian Darovotam, Ukrainian Darovotam, Ukrainian Darovotam, I thought immediately I was going to see Sinaichi Kate, like immediately, you know, just the, you know, little wooden fence and Kishikobushi. I just thought I'd see the Ukrainian village, like right there. But it was Lviv, so it was different.
So we were on this train from Lviv down to Chernivtsi, and we were on the train with these guys that we had heard them, but we really didn't know them that well at the time. It was all the guys from Nezhuresh, Viktor Morozov, Andriy Panchishin, this group of guys that would pull out a couple of guitars and just start singing on the train. We realized during this trip that these were the people that would ultimately become legends in Ukrainian music, in the Ukrainian music world. These were the guys who were like the Bob Dylans of Ukraine.
And there's Andriy Panchishin and Viktor Morozov. And there's Bratiha Yukina and Vika.
And here we were hanging out with these guys, and we would pinch ourselves and say, oh my gosh, you know, I can't believe we're hanging out and singing with these folks. Hearing these other guys perform and stuff, you know, songs that they had written, you know, original tunes and stuff, we thought, you know, we really should do something of our own, something original. And there was a demo that I had started working on before we left for Ukraine, and it was a very simple, you know, chord progression. And Roman Britan had heard this tape and got the idea to write a song about Volodymyr Ivasyuk. And it's essentially a vignette of Ivasyuk being killed.
Telling the story of Volodymyr Ivasyuk and how his music started the Ukrainian pop revolution. Basically, it inspired a lot of people to listen to and play Ukrainian music. And he had said, you know, he was a truly pop composer. It reached, you know, so many more people than just, you know, I guess choral music or traditional music. And then, you know, his brutal murder, and the idea was the moment that Ivasyuk died, it's like his spirit left his body and just went into every single Ukrainian person who was in love with Ukrainian music. And basically his spirit went into all of us. It's like, from the perspective of the person singing, it's like someone was there singing a song and then he heard Volodymyr Ivasyuk's final cry before they killed him. It's absolutely tragic the way he went, but something happened because of it. And it may not have produced this big music revolution. And Chervona Ruta Festival wouldn't have been that. It wouldn't have been in his name, possibly. I mean, he might have continued on and done great things. I mean, that's really why he was murdered, wasn't it? He wanted to continue to write in his own voice, and he didn't want to succumb to Soviet pressure, right? I mean, that's why they did him in. Basically, he just didn't want to follow what they wanted him to do.
The point of that song was that as a result of this murder, there was a nation of people born that were even more impassioned about Ukrainian music, about that art form. And by the time we got to Chernivtsi, we thought, you know, we're going to perform this song, we're going to add this to our set. To sing about a hero in a country where you couldn't express that, you couldn't openly sing Ukrainian, you couldn't speak Ukrainian. And to be Americans of Ukrainian descent standing before this audience screaming was just a surreal experience. It was not something that I could have ever imagined doing when I was a kid. Just as I could never have imagined that we would ever see a free Ukraine. When I was a kid, we attended so many, you know, political rallies and demonstrations where, you know, the chants are just, you know, ingrained in your mind, you know, free Ukraine, what do we want? Freedom. When do we want it now? Those kinds of things. To fight for the freedom of, you know, Valentin Moroz or Yuri Shukhevich. These were things that, as a kid, you thought, well, this is what we do because it's the right thing, it's the right fight, and it's, you know, it's just what we do. But never in my wildest dreams did I ever think, as a kid, that I would be performing in Ukraine, that I would be on television in Ukraine, that political prisoners would be freed, that Ukraine would be free. It's never, never even a possibility in my mind.
Well, when we got to Chernivtsi, that was, you know, that's when the festival began, and I think we were really, really blown away by the music, because we did not have any idea what to expect in terms of the Ukrainian music and where it went. What we knew of Ukrainian music, up until, for me anyway, the most modern thing that I had heard before Chernivtsi Festival was Kobza, you know, from the mid-70s, or maybe Sofia Rotaru or something like that.
And then we were very impressed by the rock, the whole heavy metal qualities, gigantic stacks of speakers, the heavy metal stuff that people wear, see the leopard pants.
I just couldn't believe it. You know, there was a real rock culture. It was pretty incredible. I was really, really blown away. People were very amazed that Slavko and I could, you know, sing in Ukrainian and speak in Ukrainian. I guess all this, you know, decades and decades of Soviet propaganda that all the immigrants, you know, all the people who left during World War II, you know, they just left Ukraine, they left the culture, they, you know, they escaped and they don't care about us, and вони не підтримують українську культуру, українську мову, you know, none of their children speak Ukrainian. That simply wasn't true.
Well, this is a photograph from the Chervona Ruta concert, and they put these beautiful backdrops of Ukrainian immigrants in the background there, and I had Snezhoti Kukarda in my hair, you know, like ribbons in my hair. But I had to wear the red and black, you know, Ukrainian sort of, you know, nationalistic, I guess, colors, you know, red and black. And then onto our concert, I was amazed by all the smoke machines, you know, made it a little difficult to sing, rocking out the joint. Everybody handing flowers and bombarding us on stage. It was totally overwhelming. I just had no words for this. This is Yurko Stasiu and Andriy Stasiu.
We were in Ukraine during a very pivotal moment in history.
So to be there and to hear people speaking in Ukrainian, and to know that doing stuff like performing Ukrainian music was at one time really not allowed was extraordinary for us. I mean, it felt like there was a revolution on hand.
People were not really singing the Ukrainian national anthem in public.
We go out there, we start playing our songs and singing, and the crowd is just going nuts, and they received us so well. And at one point I remember Darka even took out her camera and just took a snapshot of the audience.
This is a photograph I took from the stage of all the people, and there's that flag back there. I think that guy ended up in jail that night.
We thought that it might be a really cool idea to have Slavko play guitar and play the national anthem the way Jimi Hendrix did it at Woodstock.
I think it took just a few notes before the crowd realized what I was playing. And there was this roar from the audience when they realized what it was. And to me, I gotta say, it was all I could do to just concentrate on what I was playing and not be completely overwhelmed by what was happening at that moment.
It was a heavy moment. I mean, you know, first there was this distorted guitar sound, and And then the melody became self-evident what it was, and then you hear this kind of roar from the crowd, and you realize, okay, now it's clicking. People know what we're doing. People know what this is. Well, you know, the concert proceeds, and at the end of the concert, about 50 or 60 people from the audience came up to the stage, and they, you know, взялися за руки, locked arms, and sang the entire national anthem on stage in public. And people have told us it wasn't really performed on stage before that. And the reason why they locked arms was in solidarity with each other, because there was a very good chance that militia or police would come and storm the stage. I mean, I know one guy got arrested for bringing out a big Ukrainian flag. You know, he got beat up that night and went to jail.
He was a policeman battling someone who was probably acting too patriotic or something, I don't know. I'm sure that's all he was doing. He probably said Slava Ukraini and went to jail. We were told later that he just kept showing up at all these Ukrainian concerts and showing up in everybody's photographs, and he was basically a KGB agent apparently, and he was just hanging around. This gentleman came up on stage with a Ukrainian flag draped over him, and you know, that was pretty chancy. You know, this guy was definitely going to get in trouble for wearing a Ukrainian flag. That was just not done then. And he's handing me a photograph, and he's handed me this photograph of himself with Slava Ukraini on his stomach there.
And there were these, you know, guys, this militia around, that were kind of like looking at each other almost nervously at this point, because it almost felt like a riot was going to break out. I mean, a riot in a good sense, not in the sense of violence, but just celebration. And I think that to us, it almost felt like an inevitability that there was going to be some type of huge change, that, well, who knew that the wall was going to come down? But in retrospect, it's like it was no surprise. Of course it was going to come down, because look what's happening. Look what's happening behind this Iron Curtain. Things are boiling over.
In 1989, when, you know, the Iron Curtain fell, again, in what seemed like, wait a minute, that's it? And now all of a sudden, sort of instantly it seemed, instantly, it happened. And all of the things that we had been told and kind of worked towards as the Ukrainian diaspora, growing up, going to Plast Camp, going to Ukrainian school, speaking Ukrainian at home, being told by my parents all the time, "Говори по-українськи, говори по-українськи, говори по-українськи." You know, because we don't know what's going to happen back there. That might be gone. You know, all that we know about Ukraina and our culture one day could be gone from its source. So it was our job to be the light keepers. You know, to be the keepers of the flame of Ukraine. For the second Chervona Ruta Festival in Zaporizhia in 1991, 2 years after the first Chervona Ruta Festival. And it was a different experience still, because we felt that as far as we came in the first Ruta Festival, like in terms of what was going on culturally and stuff, it seemed like we had further to go, because Zaporizhia, being in eastern Ukraine, was very Russified. And whereas the crowds at the performances were very enthusiastic and everything like that, as soon as you walked outside, you were in a different world. It was also a slightly
depressing to see the state of the city. I mean, it's a very industrial city, and the pollution there was horrible. It was practically unbearable, especially if you were a singer. I mean, you'd walk around, and at the end of the day, you felt like your throat was burning, and you might have a headache because you felt like you weren't getting enough oxygen either. We performed at the Concert Laureatio, the concert that featured the laureates of the first festival. One of the things that I did realize at the festival was that music was changing fairly quickly in Ukraine. I mean, the stuff that we'd heard at the first Chervona Ruta festival seemed at times to appear a little bit dated, or like, how could I say, a little bit retro, but in a kind of a cheesy sort of way. But there was a lot of stuff that we heard there that we were amazed to hear, stuff that never got out of the country. The stuff that we heard coming out of Ukraine was the sort of the export stuff, the stuff that was on like Melodia labels, you know, the one label in the former Soviet Union. You know, and that stuff was a particular kind of music. Let's say it wasn't the underground stuff.
Cultures change, cultures evolve. To maintain it, I don't know if it can have that same drive that it had through the 60s and 70s and 80s, because you know, you don't necessarily treasure what you might not worry you'll lose.
One thing that I do remember very specifically about that trip was we were flying out of Moscow again, and we noticed the day before we flew to Moscow, we were in Kyiv. We had gone from Zaporizhia, we had flown to Kyiv. We were there for like 2 days. And we noticed one day while walking along the Dnipro River in the city, we were walking with our friend Kirill Ostatsenko. We noticed that there were helicopters flying in like a V formation over the river. And Kirill looked up and said, that's a little strange, it's a little odd. And we noticed when we got back to his apartment that the TV was only playing like a ballet. And it was just all the time ballet, no news, no nothing. The programming had just been completely interrupted and overtaken by this ballet. And he thought, this is not good. So we were getting nervous, you know, because of course, we don't know what's going to happen, you know, we're in a foreign country, we're thinking, well, what's going on? He heard from the BBC, had a shortwave radio, that there were like tanks on their way toward Ukraine, toward Kyiv or something like that. We're thinking, what's going on? And we also know that, we also hear that there's something going on in Moscow. And we were flying to Moscow the next day. We're thinking, what do we do? What's going on? We couldn't get any news. And what we finally heard, that Yeltsin was held up in the parliament building, that it was surrounded and stuff like that. And there was this, like, coup happening, you know? And, we thought, well, we have to go to Moscow because we have a flight that's leaving to go back to America. So when we landed in Moscow and we were driving in a car to an apartment, a friend had put us up for the night in Moscow. Everywhere along the street there were tanks lining the streets, and it was we were nervous, obviously, you know, guys walking around with machine guns, you know. And the apartment where we stayed was a mile away from the parliament building. And here we are at this acquaintance's home. He had satellite television, and there we are watching CNN. And they have, like, cameras trained on the parliament building just down the street from us. And, you know, we just didn't know what was going to happen. We thought, is there going to be some kind of a military coup? We were just nervous and, like, mesmerized by this television, you know, just trying to get some information. And we thought, oh gosh, what if if the airport's going to be closed, we're not going to get out of the country and stuff. And the next morning we did go to the airport quite early, and seemed like there was nobody at the airport. We thought, oh my gosh, you know, maybe the flight's been canceled, we're not going to get out. But everything was on schedule, and we got on, got through the, you know, the gate, got on the plane, and while we were in the air, we got an announcement from the pilot that, you know, that the coup was over, that everything was, you know, everything was all right.
I don't know what's next, but it's not what's been. You know, now there's a Vietnam Ukraine, now there's a free Ukraine. And what does that mean exactly? And it's kind of like that Chinese proverb of be careful what you wish for because someday it might come true. Here we were all of a sudden. It was that thing that just 2, 3, 5 years previous we thought was an impossibility. I mean, I never thought in my lifetime I would see something like that. What is our purpose now? Okay, now I guess it's more about the culture than about maintaining the culture. It's about appreciating the culture that you have as opposed to being the keepers of that.
We did something right, or we achieved something that we wanted to. And I don't think at that time we could even put into words what we wanted to achieve. We were just going on our instinct about where we wanted the music to go.
If your heritage is important enough to you, it should be important enough to you. You shouldn't have to have, you know, a foe necessarily to be able to celebrate what you are.
Get one.